Good afternoon, everyone. Could we all settle down, please, and take our seats? My name is Maryam, and I'm here with the prolific and versatile Kamila Shamsie, who at this point I think needs no real introduction. However, I will remind everyone and, you know, announce that she is now the author of 6 novels, the latest of which is A God in Every Stone, and which we're launching here today. And among her many accolades are a shortlist for the Orange Prize, and she's also a grantor British Novelist of 2013. I think I'm going to actually pass it over to Kamila almost immediately, so she can read from her new book and tell us a little bit about it, and then we can get into some really meaty questions, I hope.
Thank you for all for coming on a Saturday afternoon and sitting here. This is the world launch. It sounds very grand, but it means that it's the first time I'm actually talking about this book. So it's particularly nice to be able to do that in Karachi. A God in Every Stone is set in 1915 and 1930. Most of the action takes place in Peshawar, but the earlier bits, which are the bits I'm going to be reading from, are not in Peshawar. There are two stories. One is an English woman who's an archaeologist, and the other is a Peshawari man who's a soldier in the British Indian Army. I'm going to be reading, first of all, a section about the English archaeologist. And it opens with her in Ottoman Turkey, but this is actually her remembering when her interest in archaeology really, really started, and her association with a Turkish man, an archaeologist called Tehsin Bey. So this is her recalling their first proper meeting when she's a young child. It's in England. Tehsin Bey is a friend of the family. The girl followed the lights, the music, and the gabble of voices as they spilled from the door into the garden. As she progressed closer to the edge of the property, she realized everything that had preceded her out was being swallowed up by the darkness, so that soon only she would remain, unless the darkness swallowed her up too. Where are you going? The darkness didn't sound as she'd expected, its voice foreign. Away from that. She flicked her hand behind her at the house filled with New Year revelers waiting to cross into 1904. What she really meant was that she wanted to escape from her mother, who was attempting to send her to bed as though, at 11, she was still a child. The darkness lit a cigarette, and a man's face appeared, attached to the end of the glowing white stick. The girl had known this man all her life, but he'd only become interesting to her earlier in the evening when her father whispered into her ear, "He's an archaeologist who grew up where Herodotus did." She repeated this fact back to the man, who pulled on his cigarette, his cheeks sucking in until the girl was sure they must have met inside his mouth. "Yes," he said, "the ancient land of Caria, on the cusp of Persia and Greece, home of Herodotus, the father of history, it's true. But before Herodotus, there was Skylax, the greatest of the ancient travelers, now reduced to a speck in the corner of history's eye." The girl said, "He's traveled to India. Herodotus writes about him." The man looked at her as if she had just become a person worthy of interest. "Yes." It was the least he could do for him, Herodotus, after he stole all of Skylax's tales of India for his histories. "What do you know of him?" "Only what Herodotus tells us. The Persian Emperor Darius sent a group of men he trusted to India, including Skylax. Especially Skylax. Kaidakai, that's the emphasizing Greek phrase he uses. Especially Skylax, the most trusted. Go on." "Skylax traveled along the river Indus, and later Darius used the information he brought to go down the river and conquer India, just as the British have done." "Learned that last part from Herodotus, did you?" He laughed, and she saw the gentle mockery as a sign that he recognized her as an adult. "Let me tell you the part Herodotus never mentioned," he continued. "Darius so trusted Skylax, he gave him a silver circlet fashioned with figs, a mark of the highest honor. But 20 years later, when Skylax's people, the Carians, rebelled against Darius's Persians, Skylax was on the side of his countrymen, not his emperor." "But Darius trusted him," she said. "Oh, English girl, how quickly you side with the empire." She knew she was being chastised, but she couldn't understand why. The Turk must have seen her expression because he stood up and his voice lost its sharp edge. I'll tell you a secret if you promise to tell no one. One day I'll find it, the circlet of skylax. He swept his arm from side to side, rippling the air with fire. Somewhere beneath a patch of earth, it's waiting for the man with the will to unearth it. And part of the novel is about this archaeologist, Vivian Rose, growing up and going to Peshawar to try and find this object, this crown or circlet of figs. Because Peshawar, of course, we should all know this, but maybe we don't, is the world's oldest living city. It's been continually inhabited for, 4,000 years now. So there's a great archaeological tale to tell in there. But the other story is of an Indian soldier, as was then, because this is pre-partition, a Peshawari man who's in the British Indian Army and is fighting in World War I. And the Indian soldiers who were wounded in the First World War were all taken to Brighton if they needed to be hospitalized. There were several set, well, not all, but most of them. There were lots of hospitals set up in Brighton. So this Indian man, Kayum Gul, this Peshawari fellow, ends up in Brighton in 1915. And he gets a message from his friend Kalam Khan to say, I'm also in a hospital. It's a different hospital. So come and see me. So Kayum Gul goes off to see his friend and comrade, Kalam Khan, who is at Kitchener Hospital. And this happens. Kayum slowly approached the gate, squinting at every open window to see if a familiar form might be leaning out of it, waiting. With his attention on the upper stories, he didn't see the man in the sentry box and would have walked right through the open gate if the man, a military policeman, hadn't commanded him to stop and asked what he wanted. Lance Nek Kayum Gul, here to see Sepoy Kalam Khan, he said. No visitors allowed. What time should I come back? No visitors allowed. Because today is Sunday? No, because no visitors are allowed, any day, any time. My friend is in there. We were at Vipers, 40th Pathans. No visitors allowed. I'm a Lance Nek of the 40th Pathans. That won't stop me arresting you if you don't move along. A car with three Indians and an Englishman drove out of the open gate and stopped next to the sentry box. What's going on, the English officer said in Urdu, and Kayum, immeasurably relieved, saluted and said there was some miscommunication. His English wasn't very good. Could the officer please tell the MP he was here to visit one of the sepoys under his command? Sorry, Lance Nek, said the officer. Hospital rules, no visitors. Can you find out if he's well enough to come out? I don't know how bad the injuries are, but maybe he can walk or use a wheelchair. The officer said, no Indian personnel except NCOs are allowed out of the hospital grounds, except on supervised marches. Sir? Look, Nantnek, I didn't make the rules. But how do I see him? I'm afraid you don't. But we fought at Vipers together. Sir? He was at Auber's Ridge. He was under my command, 40th Pathans. I understand what you're trying to say. I'm extremely sorry. There's nothing I can do, not even for men who fought at Ypres. Thank you.
Wonderful. I think, Kamila, you already answered my first question, and maybe we can get a little more into it, which is why Peshawar. But I want to go on to archaeology as well, mm-hmm. which... in this novel is really, it's a profession, it's a practice, and it's a passion, I think. Mm. It's one of the kind of the underlying passions of the novel, really. And I want to kind of ask you that archaeology was a critical implement for Orientalism in the 18th and 19th and even early 20th centuries, which is when this novel is set. And it, of course, is an instrument of empire as well. But something I like that you've done in this novel is put archaeology in the hands of a young woman, a child, and finally a minority figure, which is Tahsin Bey, who is an Armenian in the novel, living during the time of the Ottoman Empire. So could you tell me a little bit about how you felt about archaeology in particular? Mm-hmm. Did you, in some sense, grapple with its empire legacy that it seems to carry with it?
Well, I'm actually going to answer the first question, why Peshawar, because I didn't actually answer fully why it happened. In 2009, I published a book called Burnt Shadows, which starts in Nagasaki. And before that, I'd always written about Karachi, so about a very familiar place. And in writing about Nagasaki, I had to discover an unknown place and then learn how to write it. As a result of which, by the time the book came out, I felt that Nagasaki of 1945 was a place that was really in my imagination, and I had a sense of what its street layout looked like and what happened there. And around that time, I was in Karachi for the launch of Burnt Shadows. And in those days, practically every day, there was a bomb going off in Peshawar. And at some point, it occurred to me that I knew a lot more about Nagasaki 1945 than I did about Peshawar in any time. And it's one of the curious things about growing up in Karachi is that you can know almost nothing about Peshawar. Lahore is, you know, it's there, it's the other city. But Peshawar is really, you know, not really in the imagination. And so I thought, well, this is, you know, strange to know more about Nagasaki. So I just started reading up on Peshawar. And there was a piece in the newspaper about the Museum of Peshawar, which is astonishingly wonderful. If anyone hasn't been, just go. It may be the best thing in Pakistan is the Peshawar Museum. And there was a piece in, I think, Dawn, when these bombs were going off daily, about fear of what would happen to the artifacts, these ancient, beautiful Gandhara statuary, whether the Taliban would target it or not, and you know, what could be done to protect it. And that started me researching, and that's where I found this man, Skylax, who is the greatest of the ancient travelers and the first man we know of to come from outside the subcontinent. Darius sent him, and he traveled down the Indus. And I became really interested in this. And I already had an interest in Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan and his Khudai Khidmatgar. And so the novel actually takes these two things together, because Qayyum Gul then ends up being a red shirt or Khudai Khidmatgar. So it started with a, you know, why do I know more about Nagasaki than this place? But once I started reading, the novelist part of me found these stories to get really engaged with, and a novel started to form out of that. As for the archaeology, it's a vexed thing because, of course, the British used archaeology as a tool of control and all of that, but I was thinking in more of terms of a contemporary Pakistani viewpoint that now this is our country, our artifacts, our history, and we don't acknowledge it. We don't all learn in school about Gandhara, which is the greatest thing possibly that this region has come up with. Yeah. So what I was doing was actually, rather, even though the book is 1915 and 1913, a colonial period, was to come at it from a 21st century perspective of, actually, we don't have to think of archaeology and artifacts as the things that the British pulled out of the soil. And, you know, of course, we had Ahmed Hassandani, one of the greatest of all archaeologists, was one of ours. And one of the things that is noted by the characters in there is in 1915, the superintendent and deputy of the Peshawar Museum were a man called Pandit Iyer and Mr. Vasiuddin. So it wasn't the Brits who were running the museum, even in as early as 1915. So I wanted to sort of reclaim archaeology as a Desi thing rather than a colonial import.
Excellent. I like that. I'm going to quote you from your recent interview where you talked to Pankaj Mishra. And you had a little bit of a fascinating discussion on the state of the novel, really. And in the interview, you say, and I'm going to quote the first phrase too, "At the risk of being branded a Philistine, I'd like to suggest that the novel is a form suited to empathy, inquiry, and a deep immersion in the lives of others, which isn't something you can separate from political views." Could you say a little bit about this particular novel and the kind of political views that are emerging in here that are not just political, but I think political personal in a way, that each individual is fighting for something?
You know, the first part of the novel, which is the English woman, Viv Spencer, is in Ottoman Turkey. And she's an archaeologist, and there's this older archaeologist who she knows and is, quite attracted to. And there's an attachment beginning to form between them. And then the First World War breaks out, and then he's the enemy because Turkey's on the opposite side. And she's asked to give information on him in the name of patriotism and the king and empire. And so she has this sort of conflicted loyalty there. And on the other hand, you have Kayum Gul, who's fighting the British in the British Indian Army, so fighting for the British in France, not really sure why. And then in Brighton discovers, because it is true that in some of the hospitals in Brighton, the Indian soldiers who'd been fighting and dying in the trenches were then treated practically as prisoners. And it was largely because the English were very worried about they see men interacting with English women. You know, they thought anything can happen there. So they were trying to keep the Indians locked in. And Kayum starts noticing that we've gone and been fighting for them, and now we're prisoners, and what really is going on here. So then his loyalty starts shifting as well. So it's a lot of way about people trying to figure out where you owe your loyalties, whether it's something you're born into in a tribe, a nation, or whether it's a gender, because Viv's sort of femaleness becomes an issue, whether it's, you know, an ethnicity, or whether it's an idea that you're fighting for.
Yeah, I think, and it's a crisis we're still struggling with, I would imagine, to some extent. Okay, I'd like to shift gears a little bit, and then maybe come back to Viv again, because I'm fascinated with her existence. But I want to talk a little bit about the eye of the novel, and this is a kind of a general statement, but something I've noticed in your past two books, so Burnt Shadows and now A God in Every Stone, you're no longer using the first-person narrative, and you have shifted to the third person, given that your first four books were largely in the first person.
Well, the first wasn't, but was third, but limited to a singular viewpoint.
And so I want to hear a little bit about the experience of shifting your narrative style and how you feel you may have grown or changed or altered as a writer doing that.
I recently read an interview with Hanif Qureshi, who said, I think every 10 years a writer becomes a new writer. I don't think this is necessarily true, because there's some writers who could take a decade to write a single book, and there's some writers who stay the same writer for 50 years, except they become worse and worse versions of themselves because they've exhausted everything they ever had to say with the topic. But it occurred to me when I read that was probably true of me, that the first four novels I wrote, from In the City by the Sea to Broken Verses, that was a 10-year period of writing them. And then there was just a shift that I wanted to do something else. And partly it was feeling I want to get out the first person, which is very confining in a way that can be useful for a novel. But I had, you know, done it enough. And was sort of sick of it. And I like with the way I've been doing it in the two novels since, is to have multiple viewpoints, and that you need to do if you are telling stories, as I have with both Burnt Shadows and A God in Every Stone, of people from different coming at history from different angles, and to be able to step into their shoes from whatever angle they are. I mean, it was important to me to be able to see through the eyes of Viv Spencer, who is an English woman who does largely buy into the idea of empire. It was weirdly much more difficult for me to do that, or for me to be generous towards her. It was easier for me to be generous and understanding of Kayum Gul, who's very patriarchal, which I find deeply troubling, but somehow, you know, I was able to do that much easier. With Viv, it took a lot for me to write and rewrite her until I was approaching a position of understanding her life enough to understand, you know, why she would carry these views, even though she's a, you know, educated, smart, in many ways enlightened woman.
Okay, coming to Viv, I'm fascinated with this character. And I think again, something that seems to have come up in a very dominant way in your past, in this novel and the past novel, are the female protagonists. And I think in Burnt Shadows, Hiroko is a figure who loves and loses, and then loves and loses again, and is inevitably solitary at the end of the narrative. And Viv is a figure who really does not have a compelling love story. She has a love story. She has a moment, and she has this deep regret also, but that she actually brushes off later on in the novel. But what I found just fantastic and so incredibly unique was that we have a female protagonist who has no partner at the end, and who really is mature enough to walk away at the end of the novel, or at least, well, a little before the end, I suppose. And could you say a little bit about where this kind of new, and she's not actually new, she's very old in a lot of ways, she's very real. So where this very real and very, I think, solitary is the only word, I don't want to use the word alone at all, but solitary and independent kind of female protagonist is coming from.
Well, of course, Hiroko in Burnt Shadows does end up solitary. She's very old by the time she ends up. The truth is most women end up solitary because most women lose their husbands. So it is actually the nature of women in, I think, every part of the world that you're far more likely than a man to end up solitary. It's also a fact that men who lose their wives are much more likely to remarry than women are. So it's simply a fact that it's strange that fiction doesn't recognize more that the nature of a woman's life, whether you're married or not, is in terms of partnering. I'm not necessarily in terms of children or friendship or other things, which certainly are important. But in terms of that, you know, coupling, most women will end up solitary. But with Viv, actually, what you'll find is of her generation of English women, there were a lot of women who didn't couple, and there were two different reasons. The one that's most often mentioned is in the First World War, so many of the men died, that demographically you had this generation of women who were young in 1915. So Viv is in her early 20s. You did have this generation where there were a lot of women who were single. But there's another part which is not talked about, which is, and you particularly find it if you're researching the women archaeologists, because to be an archaeologist, I mean, 1915 England, you know, the suffragette movement is happening, but there's still a lot of women even who think women shouldn't yet have the vote. And so to be an archaeologist and to be a woman who decides to go and travel and do all kinds of things, you are stepping out of convention. And there were a lot of women archaeologists who didn't marry, or if they did marry, they married men who are archaeologists. And you find if you're researching it, you find a lot of times where the women are making this decision that I can either have this domestic life or I can go out and I think it's a real shame that story is told much less than the story of Are Bechare, all the men died at war, so then they had to perforce be unmarried, when it was a choice being made by many to have this life of travel and the mind in a different way.
Well, thank you so much for this character. I think contemporary literature needs someone like her very badly. I'm going to move on to one other semi-solitary character as I read him. If you don't mind, I'd like to read my favorite passage from the novel, which is page 126 on mine, I suppose. So ever since, and this is really Qayyum, the Pathan soldier, has come back home with only one eye. And his younger brother is watching him and kind of, you know, feeling his crisis in some way. And I just want to read. And his younger brother is the character who works with Viv at the archaeological site and at the museum. So I want to read a little bit about this boy whose name is Najib. Ever since Qayyum had returned from England, Najib had started to feel that the world was filled with sadness. He saw it now everywhere. There, the boy with the crippled arm looking into a cage filled with clipped winged birds, the man so stooped with age he had to carry a tilted mirror in his hand in order to see the reflection of the world above knee level, the carpet seller still on his balcony making gestures of entreaty as though rehearsing what he could have said, what he should have said, what he would most certainly say if he had another chance to save that child from his sister's fate. There had been a moment when the child had looked directly at Najib, her green eyes bewildered. She couldn't have been more than 3 or 4 years old, and already it had been determined that her life would be filled with cruelty. I know the stories of men from 2,500 years ago, but I'll never know what happens to you. For me, Kamila, this was one of the most moving passages in the novel. And it's so universal in some ways in terms of time. It's something that hit me at this point while reading this, of how many stories I don't know at this point. But in terms of the novel a little bit, does it encapsulate some kind of crisis in the novel that the characters are undergoing?
So this is Najib, who's a very young boy at this point, and he sees a girl who's 4 years old, and her mother's trying to sell her off in the marketplace, except she's not really. She's trying to save her daughter from being, from being given to someone else, someone really awful, in a promise of marriage for once she grows up. When you're writing a novel, there's always this question of whose stories are you going to tell? And of course, you know, the novel started with Why Don't I Know Peshawar and its stories. So a lot of the novel is also because, you know, you do have, rather than the English figure is not the colonial man administrator, I wanted to be the English woman who is having, you know, even though she's in ruling class in terms of being English, but she has, because she's female, it's, you know, problematic in all kinds of ways. And Kayum, of course, is a soldier, but he's, you know, now lost an eye and therefore in some ways slightly marginalized, and all kinds of things are going on around that. And within the novel, there was this question of whose stories are you telling, whose stories are important. And I think there's always this danger. I mean, you know that, you know, as I'm sitting here talking about, you know, Skylax who traveled along the Indus in 515 BC, someone is sitting and thinking, but why are you writing about Skylax in 515 BC when Peshawar is blowing up today? And indeed, someone is going to be sitting here about to ask me when I'm going to write about drones, right? But Moni Mohsin is going to do that for us instead. And so there's always this question about which stories are you going to tell, and the fact that there are always stories that will be left out, and that any novelist knows this. And people will come up and say, you know, do you feel your novels reflect the complexity of Pakistan? You want to say the last thing a novel or a novelist can ever do is reflect the complexity of a country of 180 million people. I can't reflect Karachi, I can't reflect the people here. You know, what you do is you have four or five central characters, you tell their stories, and you hope that illuminates something. You know, as a writer, you're working with that little torch, not the big spotlight, but a little beam somewhere. But there are always the stories left out, and, you know, there are always the stories you're not telling. So it's a crisis of the novelist, I think, as much as, yeah, as within the novel as well. There are people who are always unaware of other lives. They know their own life, which feels to them obviously central, that this is the central perspective. For the English woman, she has what she thinks is a rather, you know, liberal view of empire, but she's still an imperialist. And Kayum thinks that he's, you know, in many ways, you know, a man of the people and all that, but he doesn't really know very much about the lives of any women.
Yeah, and I think that speaking of diversity and actually, you know, shining that torch, one of course, something I think you've always been concerned with in your work is language, sometimes etymology, sometimes anagrams. Mm. And here, I mean, I liked your emphasis on, there was a part in the novel where we're reminded that Najib and his family speak Hindko and not Pashto, which is, I think, an important distinction to make, which many of us just kind of, you know, just mess up all the time. And there's this lovely sentence in a letter that Najib Gul writes to his brother, where he says, "How long will your Lala? How long will your friends' wedding celebrations go on? My footsteps are an intruder in the silence of the house." And I wanted to ask you a little bit: where is this language coming from? Did you listen to Hindko? Did you kind of research Hindko in some way? Did you read certain narratives to kind of achieve this kind of voice within these letters?
No, totally made up.
Totally made up.
Totally made up. I mean, I don't, you know, I don't know Hindko. So, I mean, you know, I went to some, I mean, I read up about the language, but you end up reading these academic texts which are telling about the origins of language and what it sounds like. Mm-hmm. So what I did do was go and, you know, try and find, any interviews or anything I could of people from Peshawar at the time. But largely, it's, you know, at a certain point as a novelist, you just turn to inventiveness.
Okay, so speaking of inventiveness, I want to ask you a little bit about, you know, what this shift, this moment in your kind of in your sixth novel history is like, where you've suddenly, you know, you've written about Nagasaki, you've written about Peshawar. What made you, you know, make this shift in your writing career? We've talked a little bit about the 10-year mark, where, of course, you have to kind of reinvent yourself to some extent. But tell us a little bit more about the research process, how that becomes different, how familiarity is, you know, no longer available to you, and how that in some way changes the way you write, even to some extent.
I think my writing process is completely different now, because when I was writing about Karachi, it was, you know, I used to write mostly while in Karachi. So literally, you know, if you forget what something looks like, you drive down to see it. Or you look outside and whatever the temperature is in June is the temperature in June. But it does mean that the world around is sort of given to you, which can make you lazy, I suspect, in some ways also. But it wasn't a conscious decision for me to step away from that, because I used to always say, you know, when I write, I must write about Karachi. That's my subject. In fact, the truth of it was, all I was really saying was, I've only ever written about Karachi. That's only ever been my subject. I told myself that meant it could only ever be my subject. When I started thinking about Burnt Shadows, it was originally going to be a novel primarily about Karachi, but there'd be a character whose grandmother was a Japanese woman from Nagasaki who'd ended up in Karachi. And I started thinking about it. I thought, well, what's her life? What's her story? And so I sort of, against my will, because I'd become interested in her via this Karachi idea, started writing about Nagasaki, and then discovered what it's like to enter a place from a position of unfamiliarity and through research get to know it, and to become immersed in a place and its history and its topography and its maps and all kind of things. I strongly believe if you landed me up in Nagasaki in 1945, I could find my way around there with no problem and would tell you where the newspaper printing shop is and where the butcher was and, all kinds of things. And so with Peshawar, I thought, well, if you can do that in Nagasaki, you can do that with Peshawar. And it's one of the great ironies, of course, that by this point I was living in London, because I moved there right as I was finishing Burnt Shadows. And it's very easy, when you're in London, to step into Peshawar in 1915 and 1930, because one of the things the colonials did was they kept records.
Oh, fantastic.
And the British Library has literally thousands of photographs of Peshawar from this picture. They have photographs of every artifact in the Peshawar Museum. They have all the archaeological survey reports from this period. So to be able to enter all of this through the position of research. But then there's another aspect, and we haven't really talked about this, but the latter part of the book is all set in about 3 days in 1930, and it's the massacre at Kisakhwani, which again should be an integral part of our history. I know more about Jallianwala Bagh than I do about the massacre of Kisakhwani, which was a really seminal moment. And in fact, in researching that, I found, I was doing primary research, that there are documents going back to original inquiry reports. And I think I uncovered something which I hadn't found any of the research around it, which is to do with complicity in the disposal of bodies. So it was actually then I felt more like a historian going and finding these original records and documents that the British were keeping very, you know, under lock and key at the time, about what happened during this massacre, who was responsible, how did it break out, and what happened to the bodies. And a big part of the latter half of the novel is what happened to the bodies. And there is this shock of discovery when you're coming up with really significant historical information in these archives. And it's a completely different feel, and then weaving that into a narrative is a completely different feeling to writing about, you know, the small world within Karachi in which you grew up.
And I know from your acknowledgements that you visited Peshawar. Mm-hmm. And I want to ask a little bit about what you found when you visited a city which is obviously so altered and yet has so much of the architecture you described. The bazaars are still there. The names are still there, I think, in a very big way. And even the people, in a way, I think, that you describe are very much alive. And so how was the experience of actually being a stranger in Peshawar, walking through, how did your, in a sense, writer's eye kind of conceive of the city at that time?
Yeah, it was strange because I'd actually written a draft of the novel before I went to Peshawar. And I was quite nervous about going precisely because I know that Peshawar today is so vastly changed from the Peshawar of 1915 and 1930. And I'd been talking to a friend of mine, Andrew Miller, who's a wonderful novelist. And he and I had both written books of Japan around the same time. But the difference is I've never been to Japan. And Andrew had lived in Tokyo for a while, and then he'd written about Tokyo. And I said, oh, well, you know, you're lucky you had that. And he said, actually, no, I wish I hadn't. He said, because I knew contemporary Tokyo. I was writing about an older Tokyo. And what I found was that I had to strip away my images and memories of contemporary Tokyo in order to get to a very different city that existed beyond. So I was actually very worried about going to Peshawar because I had, by then, with these photographs and descriptions and all kinds of things, I had a fairly clear sense of what it had looked like, and I was a bit worried about, you know, putting too much of these present images in. So I did a very targeted trip, which is to say I went to the museum, and then I went to the old city, and Gorkhatri, and, you know, Kisakhwani, and areas around it. And of course, as you say, a lot of that architecture is there, and the people. And I did find, you have these shocking moments. There's I was with my father's best friend who'd taken us, and he has had a video, and afterwards I was watching the video, and there's a boy on the video, and I thought, that's Najib Gul. I mean, that's my character. That's what he looks like. So I now have a photograph from 2012 of a boy who I wrote about in 1915. So there are these moments where you realize these are the people. And it's very useful to do things like to go up on a rooftop and see what the view is. And as a writer, that's what you're looking from. When my characters were on this rooftop here, what would they have been able to see? Can they see the mountains? Can they see the minarets of Muhammad Khan Mosque? Can they see Gorkhatri? Can they see the fort? And then just to have a sense of the narrowness or width of the alleys and things like that, and the architecture, which is very important. But and the museum, which is, again, I say everyone go to this museum, which is in many ways largely unchanged. And again, characters who I'd mentioned who sort of have walk-in parts, like Mia Vasiuddin and Spooner and Oral Stein, to see their names there and to see the artifacts which I've written about, you know, to have them there across the glass cabinet. And the curator of the museum, Mr. Serai, was very helpful in talking to me about the artifacts and other things.
And I think that there's, in addition to that, there's a very serious intimacy you've captured in these final chapters, which is through two women, Zarina and Diva, and two women who I think are very, very different from Viv. I said earlier that Viv knows exactly when to walk away. These women are women who refuse to walk away and will stand there until they are killed or until they have done their duty, really. And where did you find these women, or where did, you know, where do these women come from in the narrative, and what's their place, really?
Where do you find strong Desi women? Well, look around. It's not hard. Well, of course, I mean, that's part of the point near the end, is Viv can literally walk away from Peshawar because she's from London, whereas these Peshawari women, where that is their home. I realize as I'm saying this that I'm from Karachi and I'm in London. We'll ignore that particular irony. But of course, in 1915, they didn't have that option, and with their, you know, that's home. That's where you stand and fight. And it is sort of, so the girl who in that section you read, which I'm glad you did, when Najib says, oh, I know the story of 2,500 years ago, I'll never know anything about your life. She does come back later because I want to make sure that you knew about her life. And in fact, that Najib, although he doesn't realize it's the same girl, knows something about her life. But I did want to make sure that it wasn't just a story of the English woman and the man from Peshawar, that there was this other story. And again, you do, when you find your research, you there are cases when this massacre happened of women being killed as well. It's sort of a woman who goes out to find her husband and is killed and other things. So it was part of the historical record, but those are the parts that are very often not told.
So I think one of the things you're doing here is also making some kind of contribution to history, because I think one of the big things that's lacking in the major historical narratives available today is the role of women. And in some way, these two women are a female army of some kind. They are a kind of very serious fighter. And I think, would you like to talk a little bit about your engagement with history, given that this is a historical novel in so many ways?
Well, I always loved history. History and literature were the two great loves of my life. And the thing, of course, that got interesting with Peshawar was when I grew up, I used to read about Alexander the Great and the Greeks, and this is our post-colonial state, that I knew a lot more about the mythology of Greece than, on most parts of the subcontinent. But I always thought about it as someone else's history. And, of course, you read about Peshawar, and, of course, the Greeks were there for ages. And then the Indo-Greeks, who were cut off from Greece and never went there but still spoke Greek. And did anyone know that the first woman to appear on an Indian coin was an Indo-Greek queen called Agatha Clare in about 10 BC? No one knows about Agatha Clare. She was the regent. And there's a fascinating set of coins. I'm going totally on a tangent, but I like talking about Agatha Clare. There's a set of coins which shows that probably when her husband died, her son was very young. So she puts herself on the coin, and she's made to look like Athena, the goddess of war. And there are these inscriptions about the godlike queen, Agatha Clare, and she's clearly trying to make a claim for herself as a queen on the basis that Athena, the Greek queen, is female. Why can't a woman be a queen? And then as the years go by, you see her son's face also appears on the coin. So then it's the two of them. And the word godlike disappears from her. So just Agatha Clare and Strato. And then eventually she disappears altogether, and it's just Strato, the son. And you see this woman literally over these series of coins being pushed out of history. But I've always loved history, and particularly with Peshawar, the fact that every empire went through them. It's just extraordinary. You had the Persians, you have the Greeks, you have the Kushans, you have, of course, the great Buddhist kingdoms, you have the Sassanids, the Parthians, everyone. Everyone's gone through their every layer of history is in its soil. So it's so rich. And yes, the fact that we so often deny our ancient history makes it feel like more of a discovery and more pressing to get it. But I'm also very interested in the history of the 20th and 21st century. And that period of colonial rule, and that question, of what was this country before it was this country. And I do think the story of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan and the Khudai Khidmatgar is a very important part of the story of Pakistan, and again, one that gets, pushed the sidelines. So those are stories I wanted to bring together. History just, there are great stories in there. As I said, a lot of the most interesting things for me in the novel were things that actually happened. And very often when I stuck for plot, I would go back to the research and find, oh, this really interesting thing actually happened. Let's just throw it in the novel.
Fantastic. I love that women are coming back into the dominant narrative of culture, especially in ours. Okay, I think we have around 17 minutes left now, so I don't want to go into another question at this point. Yes. You would like to ask a question? First of all, so you're first in line.
Okay, there are mics coming around, I think, to help the audience. So if you could just raise your hand for the young man with the mic in the center there.
Is it on? First of all, my compliment, Ms. Shamsie. I'm amazed at your knowledge of history. My question is that I have had the honor of attending a session with you in respect of your last novel, The Burnt Shadows. And you said that you tried to go to Japan, Nagasaki, but you were disallowed. You did not get the visa. And you researched on Google what was Nagasaki before the bombing and what was after the bombing. And that was the basis of your novel. In fact, I wanted to ask about the present novel. What was the source and method of your research in this novel? Especially, the character of Skylax really amazes me, fascinates me. What was the method of your research in respect of Skylax?
Skylax is a character who we know very little of. So we know there. I mean, again, it was Google is very helpful, and then the British Library, which you know is a great source if you're a writer, is to go and try and find every piece of information. They're tiny scraps. So we know that he was in the employ of Darius, that he went down the Indus, that he wrote about it, and that he brought back. He was a writer as well, a traveler, and he told these very exaggerated tales of India. So he would say, for instance, in India you have a tribe of people, because it's so hot, he was very concerned with the heat of India. And when we talk about India, actually we're talking about contemporary day Pakistan, because he went from what was then Kaspatyros, which is either Peshawar or Attock. And he went from then traveled down the Indus and then went round the Persian Gulf. So it is present-day Pakistan. And he would say things like, you know, there's a tribe of people with very large feet. And in the afternoon when it gets very hot, they lie on their back and they hold up their feet above them like an umbrella, and it forms shade, drops shade all around them. And there's another tribe of men who have ears like winnowing fans. So they just, you know, cool them all the time. And these sort of extraordinary tales, and that created sort of the Western imagination's idea of India for about a couple of hundred years was formed almost entirely from Skylax telling these great stories. So, I mean, you know, what I like to say is we complain that the West misrepresents us now, but they've been doing it for 2,500 years. So it was really to go into the library and to go and find every source of information. And there were about 6 or 7 scraps of information on him, which I pieced together. I invented the artifact. The fig circlet doesn't exist, but everything else is, I'm sort of working out from what there is. Aristotle refers to him. Herodotus refers to him. There are a lot of later travelers who will refer back to his work. So we have little scraps in history here and there. He's one of those hidden figures that you need a novelist to take the scraps and say, well, I can pretty much guess this may have been the story.
I'm wondering, over the 6 novels that you've written, what's become easier and what's become harder as a novelist?
Everything becomes harder, because the stuff that's easy you don't want to do. So you are constantly making it more difficult for yourself, because you have to be more ambitious. You can't, you know, I could write a novel like In the City by the Sea, I'm sure, with greater ease today, but I wouldn't want to. So it becomes more difficult because with the first few novels, I think you can mine your own experiences more. And after a while, you have to stop doing that and finding something much more outside yourself. So you're always raising the bar, and therefore you're always making more difficult. And if you're not making more difficult, you get worried. If it's too easy, then there's probably a problem there and you need to try something. You get better at certain things, but then you find new things too. It doesn't make much sense as a way of living, really, the more I think about it.
There's a young man over there who's been waiting a little bit, and then we can come to you. So.
Hello, Kamila.
Hi.
My name's Nadir. I think we met last year, if you remember. Mm-hmm. My question today is that in approaching a historical narrative, wondering, is it better to tackle it with your imagination first and then diving into the fine-tuned details of history, or making the boundaries of history first and then I think it restricts the narrative. Do you think, can you comment on the approach? What would be a better approach, to tackle the story first and then fine-tune the details of history, or research history first and then dive into the narrative?
I do both. I mean, you start with history. I mean, I start with history. I had to find out certain details, and then I start writing. But I was researching all the way through the book. And history can be very useful. I'll give you an example. In the novel, Viv Spencer goes to Peshawar in 1915 to dig up an artifact that she's desperate to find. And then she doesn't come back till 1930. And the reason was I wanted her then, there in 1930, when this massacre happens. But I couldn't find a good reason why she didn't go back between 1915 and 1930. If she's so desperate to find this artifact, there was a reason for her to leave, but why wouldn't she come back? And I tried to invent all kinds of, you know, novelistic reasons which weren't very good. And then I was looking at the Archaeological Survey of India Frontier Circle for the years and discovered that actually where she was wanting to dig, which is a place called Shaji Ki Dheri, which was a great Kushan stupa was built, there was differences between the British and the landowner who owned that place. So although they did originally excavate in 1910, 1911, they couldn't then agree on the price for the British to lease the land from the landowner. And they were caught in disputes for years about this. And then, and around 1915, when she's there, they're still thinking we can easily resolve this dispute and, you know, we'll be digging this winter. And by 1918, they decide it's not worth it because the excavation has been left open to the elements and they all get sick of this landowner who wants to grow his sugar cane there and get a good price for it. So they raise the excavation. It's leveled and returned to cultivation. And it was fantastic. Oh, that's why she doesn't go back, because that you know, it's not there for the archaeologists anymore. In a weird little twist, while I was writing the novel, the location of Shaji Ki Dheri was rediscovered. Because while they were, when they went and returned it to cultivation, it sort of disappeared and no one knew where it was. And now with infrared imaging, they've been able to locate this great ancient site outside Peshawar once again. But really, I go with as you're writing the novel, you discover what else you need to know and what else you need to research. And I try to stick with those details as much as possible. I mean, I'm with Hilary Mantel, who said, I'll make up a man's thoughts, but I won't make up the color of his wallpaper. So I think where there are historical details to find, I find them, and they're not at all restrictive. I think they guide the novel in a really interesting way.
There's a gentleman over here, in the front to your left, I think, yeah.
Kamila, I just want to know, you are a very young woman.
Not so young.
And you have...
It's been 16 years since my first book.
You have a whole life ahead of you. Would you continue with this historically researched kind of novels, or do you have other things in mind in the future?
You know, as I said, when I wrote my first four novels, I'd say I was only writing novels about Karachi, and now I'm not. And, you know, maybe it's true that there is a 10-year period in the life of every novelist and something changes. I have no idea what the next book is, let alone what I'll be writing in 10 or 15 years. So I don't know. I mean, I'd hope that there would be, that, you know, I wouldn't keep doing the same thing over and over. But I couldn't tell you what I might do next. For the moment, history is incredibly interesting.
Oh, there's a question right there.
Kamila, Burnt Shadows is a novel that I loved so much that I published in French, as you know. It's a novel that actually sweeps over four generations and four continents, if I may say, with a dominant feminine figure whom, and I will be a bit more distinctive from Maryam, she doesn't end up really alone. She ends up victorious because she's the one who survives absolutely everything. Mm-hmm. But this new novel seems to sweep over two continents as well. Does this mean that you're going global? Does this mean that you have a wish today, which is to write the global novel in something that is more universal and that appeals to more and more readerships across the world?
I don't believe in the universal. I think this, you know, I was in a writers' conference in Edinburgh last year, and there were writers standing and saying certain things are universal. And then I stood up to speak, and at the moment I stood up, rain started falling. You could hear it, really heavy rain. And I said, rain. Well, now if you're in Karachi, it rains, and you run out, and you think, relief. And if in Scotland it rains, you think, oh, God, more rain. I mean, you know, even rain isn't universal in as much as our responses to everything are particularized. But of course, we're also all human beings, and so there are, you know, and we all have an imagination, and we read across. But I'm interested in the particular. I'm interested in particular histories, but what I also know is that it's very hard to contain a lot of those histories within one location. So this was originally going to be a novel that was entirely set in Peshawar. But as I was writing, I thought, well, so much of the preceding story of both Viv and Qayyum is in other places, so I need to write those other places in order to write Peshawar. And I think that may be more the point of what I'm interested in is the idea that, you know, well, no man is an island. No island is an island either. No city is an island. So that when you talk about one place, very often, not always, and this is to say nothing against the novel which is set in a single house. I mean, Marilyn Robinson is one of the greatest of all novelists writing today. Marilyn Robinson can write in Housekeeping one house, and it's one of the best novels anyone has written in ever. So it's nothing against that, but it's to say that very often you're telling the history of one place and the stories of one place, you're also telling the stories of other places. And I think that's what I'm interested in. And of people who are in the same place but are approaching history from different angles. And I will say one thing also about Hiroko end up in solitude. And of course, Hiroko ends up, you know, as a woman in her 70s, 80s, with her very dear old friend Elizabeth. So she ends up, as many women do, with her other women friends. there's a question there.
Right there.
Can you hear me?
Not really.
Kamila, my question is simple. It's about the very act of writing. Mm. In beginning a novel, I mean, I don't know, but I'm sure you conceive of a storyline, but I'm interested to know if the characters that you create take a life of their own, you know, and do they impact the story that you want to tell, or are you in control through the novel? It would be interesting to know if their lives and the way they are, and specifically cross-cultural interactions, do they shape the way the story goes, or you stick to your initial mapping of whatever it is?
I know very little about a novel when I started, so I don't have the story mapped out. I know enough to get started, and it's the act of writing itself that engenders more ideas. So as I'm writing, and all these things go together, the character, the plot, you know, they're working together, and I am making it up as I go along, and there are always times when the character surprised me. So in Burnt Shadows, Hiroko, who ends up being the main character, she was originally supposed to be a very marginal character who would be dead by page 20, you know. And sometimes what happens is someone, a particular character, will seed themselves in your imagination much more fully. With this novel, Qayyum Gul was originally supposed to be a much more tangential character, and his brother Najib, the archaeologist, would be the central character, and that end up switching. So it does happen that as you're writing, as I'm writing, there's a process of discovery, which means first drafts are very tense because I don't know what I'm doing. And there are days you sit there thinking, I have no idea what the next sentence is. So there's always that.
Okay, our very last question right there, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
From what I understand, you seem to have written about this time and these characters in a very non-prejudiced way. You haven't seemed to have imposed a theme to do with racism or... you seem to have just told the story and the characters how they were. But from what you read earlier about the soldier trying to go and see his colleague, his fellow soldier, and not being allowed in, and then when the man says Indian soldiers are not allowed to roam around these times or in these areas... So basically my question is, how much is racism or prejudice a theme? And do you make a conscious effort to leave out any kind of overarching theme where you're trying to show something that was there? I mean, how much is it the story you want to tell, and how much are these themes of racism and prejudice important to you?
I think what you have to do is, there are always sort of ideas that are interesting. But you have to tell anything through a story. It has to work with the story. So, you know, it's not that you're suddenly going to stand on a soapbox and deliver a little monologue on racism. But you show a man trying to get in to see his wounded best friend, who is not allowed in, that is revealing something about the times. I mean, you can't write about colonial India without writing about, without the inequality of race coming into it, because you're trying to write about it in a way that reflects how it really was. So if you're writing about a particular period in time, things that were part of it will come through, and I'm aware of them, and I'm interested in the ideas around it. But as a novelist, I have to make everything work with the story. And if it doesn't work with the story, if I can't find a way to make it work with the story, then I have to leave it out. But I am conscious of, you know, the larger structural stuff that's going on. But you work, you know, in a fine, on a fine scale.
Okay, there's a sentence in this novel which goes, "Enough," she says. And I think we're out of time now. It's 1:30. So I'm sorry if there are any questions and queries that I left.
I will be signing books. Kamila is going over to be here that side,
to talk
I think.
To everyone. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed.